Welcome to Steps to Life. Ask the beasts, and they will teach you, and the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth, and it will teach you. And the fish of the sea will explain to you. Who among all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this?
This morning I mentioned that in regard to the common theological reasons that are given by former Adventists as to why they are not Adventists anymore, in addition to the idea that, well, somebody in the church treated me wrong, or that's a common one, but in addition to that, there are five common theological reasons given by former Adventists as to why they are not Adventists anymore. These may be summarized as follows. We covered one this morning, which was, how is a person saved? And they say, well, you don't understand the right way a person's saved. You're a legalist. You believe that you're saved by keeping the Sabbath. And we studied that this morning. Second one is the significance of the Sabbath. We covered that one too, but I'm going to cover that one a little bit more because there are certain objections that they have to what we teach about the Sabbath being the seal of God that we need to look at. And the third one is concerning the spirit of prophecy, the writings of Ellen White. The fourth one is the investigative judgment. And the fifth one has to do with the identification of the remnant. They object to those teachings. And we're going to study mainly this evening the investigative judgment, because the investigative judgment is used to prove that Ellen White is a false prophet. Therefore, you can reject the spirit of prophecy. That's very, very commonly done by former Adventists. They say the investigative judgment is not a biblical doctrine. You can't show it from the Bible, and therefore Ellen White is a false prophet. Now, we're going to study the investigative judgment tonight, and we're not going to even look at the spirit of prophecy. We're not going to read one sentence of what Ellen White wrote. We're just going to look at the Bible alone. And I want you to be able to see that the investigative judgment was derived right straight from the Bible. But before we do that, I want to finish something that we didn't have time to finish this morning, and that has to do with the Sabbath. And you remember, I mentioned this morning, we know from Revelation 7 that God has a seal, a special seal, and this seal is mentioned in the New Testament. There are several texts I could read about the seal. We read this morning about the seal, and the seal has to do with receiving the Holy Spirit. There's no question about that. And every Christian is to be sealed. Every Christian. And Paul told the Christians in those days that they had already been sealed. And we read those verses in 2 Corinthians 1 and in Ephesians 1. There's no question about that. But in addition to that, Revelation 7 makes it very clear that God has a special seal that not all Christians will receive. God has a special seal that only 144,000 will receive. That's very clear in Revelation 7. It talks about an innumerable company that are saved in the last part of the chapter, but it specifies that there are 144,000 that are going to receive this special seal. Now, this is not a seal that they received when they became Christians. To those who became Christians, Paul said, you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit. This is not a seal that they received when they became Christians because they were already Christians before they had received this seal. It says that we may, until I may seal the servants of God in their forehead. So they're already servants of God. They're already God's children. But they're going to receive a seal. Now, I want to point out several things about this special seal. Number one, I mentioned this morning that even in the Old Testament, it is taught that in the last days, there's a prophecy in Ezekiel 9 about the last days, how that the people are going to receive a special mark. And if you receive this mark, you're going to be delivered. It's a mark of deliverance. And Revelation teaches that most of the people in the world in the last days are going to receive a mark of destruction. It's called the mark of the beast, and it's a mark of destruction. If you receive that mark, you will be destroyed, period. That's the third angel's message. In fact, the emphasis in the latter half of the book of Revelation is all over two things. Have you gained the victory over the beast, the image and the mark, or have you received the mark? That determines your destiny. For instance, in Revelation 15, you have a picture of the people that had gained the victory over the beast, the image and the mark, and they're standing with Jesus on Mount Zion. That's Revelation 15, 2 and 3. In Revelation 16, you have a picture of the people that received the mark of the beast, and what did happen to them? They received the plagues. You can see that in Revelation 16, 2. In Revelation 19, 20, when Jesus comes, it talks about the people that had been deceived and received the mark of the beast and worshiped the beast in his image in Revelation 19, 20, and they're all destroyed. That's Revelation 19, 20. And then Revelation chapter 20, verse 4, the people that did not receive the mark of the beast or worship the beast in his image, they were with the Lord in heaven for 1,000 years. So that is emphasized so many times that if you're a Christian and you're living in these days, we all want to understand thoroughly and carefully what the mark of the beast is and how to avoid receiving it. What, though, is the seal or the mark of God? Here's several points. In the New Testament, the word for seals, phragizo is the word, it means, you can find this in Little and Scott's lexicon of the Greek New Testament, it means to mark as with a seal or just to make a mark. So that's what the word seal means that's used in Revelation and other places in the New Testament. It means to mark as with a seal or just to mark. So a seal and a mark are the same thing. You understand that? To seal something is to mark it. In the where the word seal actually comes from, in ancient times, people that were wealthy or always with kings or people that had a lot of money, they had what we call a signet ring. And with that signet ring, you impressed a document. It's like signing a check. It made it official. And so you remember in the story of the prodigal son, when the son came home, you remember what the father did? He gave him a ring. You know what that meant? That meant he had access to the family's checking account. They had banks in those days. They had checking accounts in those days. He had access to the family's bank account. So to seal something is, like we would say, to sign it, to mark it. So a seal and a mark are the same thing. You can check it in Little and Scott's lexicon. And the Hebrew word oath also means to sign or mark or a pledge of the covenant. And when we look in the Old Testament, we find that ever since ancient times, God has had a special mark that if you have this mark, that means that you belong to Him and He belongs to you. Let's read first a few verses about the mark, just in general, and then we'll look at some specific ones. Look in Exodus. It says, "It shall be as a sign to you on your hand and as a memorial between your eyes, that the Lord's law may be in your mouth, for with a strong hand the Lord has brought you out of Egypt." What was it that was going to be a sign? It was the Lord's law. If you look in Deuteronomy 6, and verse 8, it's talking about teaching the law to your children. It says, "You shall bind them as a sign on your hand. They shall be as frontlets between your eyes." Verse 18 says, "You shall do what is right and good in the sight of the Lord, that it may be well with you, and that you may go in and possess the good land of which the Lord swore to your fathers." And so, obedience to God's law was to be a sign. It was to be bound as a sign. That's verse 8. Now, if you look in Deuteronomy 11, it says in verse 18, "You shall lay up these words of mine in your heart and in your soul and bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes." So the law of God was to be a sign that set the children of Israel apart from other nations. But there is a certain part of the law that signifies that you are a law keeper and you belong to the Lord. Let's read and see what that is. Look in Exodus 31. Exodus 31, verse 13. It says, "Speak also to the children of Israel, saying, surely my Sabbaths you shall keep, for it is what? It is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I am the Lord who sanctifies you." Notice the Sabbath is a sign that the Lord is going to make us holy. And it's a perpetual covenant, that is verse 16. And it says in verse 17, "It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever, for in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed." And then look at Ezekiel, the 20th chapter. "Moreover, I also gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between them and me, that they might know that I am the Lord who sanctifies them." Verse 20 also talks about the Sabbath being a sign. Look also at Isaiah 8. And this is a very interesting text because, remember, the word sign or mark or seal are all synonym words. But notice the word used here in Isaiah 8. And incidentally, if you want to read the whole context, you'll find that this is a prophecy about the last days. Isaiah 8. It says in verse 16, it says, "Bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples." Notice, God's seal involves his law. Seal up the law. Seal up the law. This should not seem unusual because even human laws must be sealed. Ancient covenant documents, now remember, the Ten Commandments are called God's covenant, Deuteronomy 4:13 and other places. And ancient covenant documents had a seal. And in ancient times when they made a covenant and they sealed it, where was the seal located? The seal in an ancient covenant document was always located in the center of the document. Now, we put the seal at the end of the document today, but they didn't do that in ancient times. They put the seal in the center of the document. You ever looked at the Ten Commandments to notice where the center of the Ten Commandments is? Do you know what the center word of the Ten Commandments is? In English, it's the word "is." The center sentence in the Ten Commandments, you know what the center sentence of the Ten Commandments is? The center sentence of the Ten Commandments are, "The seventh day is the Sabbath." That's the center sentence of the Ten Commandments. And remember, in ancient covenant documents, all ancient covenant documents had a seal in the center. There's a reason that the Sabbath wasn't put in the beginning or the end of the Ten Commandments. It's put right in the center because that's where the seal of ancient covenant documents was located. Now, when you look at the commandments, today, let's just take a commandment. Exodus 20, verse 14. What's that? That's the seventh commandment. You shall not commit adultery. Now, even people that claim to be Christians today don't think very, very much about this commandment. It's broken constantly all over the world. And so young people say, well, what authority is this? What authority? Well, why? What is the authority? You know, see, it's like we were talking this morning. If I came and told you, do not commit adultery, well, so what? I'm just a human being. See, that doesn't have any authority because I'm just a human being. Well, what gives authority when God says you shall not commit adultery? What is it that gives authority to that? What is it that gives authority to it? Remember what I was talking this morning? In my home when I grew up, who had the authority? Me or my father? Who had the most authority? The father had authority. So the thing that gives that commandment, you shall not commit adultery, the reason that has authority is because who is speaking? Does that make sense? That's a reason. That's the reason that it's wrong to commit adultery, because of who said it. Well, who said it? Well, you have to go to the fourth commandment to find out who said it. The fourth commandment says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall you labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. And then it's specified that there's seven different individuals mentioned that are not to work. And then it gives you the reason. And the reason is because in 6 days God created the heavens and the earth and rested the seventh day, wherefore he blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it or made it holy. So who is speaking in the text? When the Lord says, you shall not commit adultery, why should that have authority and force in your life? Because of who's talking. And the person that's talking is the person that created the heavens and the earth in 6 days and rested the seventh. He's the one that created everything. He's the one that created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, and he's the one that's telling you this. Does that have authority? Well, that has authority because of who's talking. So the Sabbath commandment is the commandment that gives all the rest of the law authority. It's the commandment that gives all the rest of the law authority. And of course, that's what a seal does. A seal is what gives authority to a law. When we make a law in the United States, until the president has signed it, it's not the law. Even though Congress has passed it, until the president has signed it and it's sealed with the president's seal, it's not the law. So a seal makes a law authentic and genuine and gives it authority. And the Sabbath is what gives the Ten Commandments authority. Just read the whole Ten Commandments. What gives any of the one of the commandments says, you shall not bear false witness. Well, why? Because of who's talking. Because of who's talking. You're not to covet what belongs to somebody else. Well, why? Because who's talking? It's the person that's talking that gives authority to everything. And without if you take the Sabbath commandment out, do you know what you have done? You have removed the authority of the law. And do you realize, friends, that this is one of the reasons that the law of God is considered so lightly by so many people today? Because they don't realize the authority it has. They've been taught the theories of evolution. They don't even believe the fourth commandment. So the law has no authority. The law has no authority for them. They say, well, that's just what they believed back in those days. And they have all kinds of reasons that they gave it. They don't even know that it has divine authority because the Sabbath commandment's been taken out. Well, you study that more on your own. You see that the Sabbath has been a seal, a sign, a mark of God's children ever since the beginning of time. So Adventists, when they started studying this subject in the seal of God in Revelation 7 and trying to figure it out, you go all the way through the Bible. What is the seal of God? The seal of God always has involved obedience to His commandments, even in Bible times. The seal involved obedience to God's commandments. Read 2 Timothy 2:18 and 19. The seal of God involves obedience to His commandments. But now I want to go to another subject because we're going to run out of time if we don't hurry there. I want to go to the subject of the investigative judgment because, as I said, people who are former Adventists, this seems to be their favorite whipping boy for them to say, well, that's not biblical. You can't show that from the Bible. And so this idea that the judgment began in 1844 and there's an investigation and so forth, that just, we can't find that in the Bible. And if you tell somebody something 100 times, they might believe it. And that's what I've noticed that former Adventists tend to do. They just say over and over and over and over and over again, and they write it in their books and in their magazines. They just say bombard you over and over and over and over again and say, you can't find it in the Bible. I say, wait a minute. Have we searched? Let's just look in the Bible. And we're not going to look anything in Ellen White's writings or any Adventist material. We're just going to look in the Bible, same Bible everybody has. And we're going to see what does the Bible say about the judgment. And we're just going to look at a bunch of Bible texts quickly and see what the Bible says about the judgment. This is not my ideas. This is not the Adventist ideas. This is not the Adventist of Ellen White or the church. This is right in the Bible. You can read it in your Bible. If you have a Bible, let's look at several things quickly. First of all, is there going to be a judgment, and is the judgment going to be at a specific, specified time? Well, that's very plain. The Apostle Paul taught that. So look in your Bible in the book of Acts, the 17th chapter. Acts 17, verse 31. Notice what Paul says. He's taught. Now, by the way, Paul's here. He's in an evangelistic campaign, and this is his very first sermon. And the very first sermon, he's talking to heathen philosophers, and the very first sermon he preaches, which is the only one he preaches to them, he talks about the judgment. Notice what he says. Verse 31. Because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained, he has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. See, they didn't want to believe in the judgment of God either. And Paul said, listen, God has given you assurance this is going to happen, because the fact that Jesus was raised from the dead is assurance, evidence that God is going to judge the world, and he's going to judge it when? He's appointed a certain time, a certain day when he's going to do it. The Apostle Paul was preaching about the judgment all the time. When he preached to Felix, you look over here in Acts 24. Acts 24, and now he's going to preach to Felix. Now, this is the same thing. He only has one chance. He's only going to preach one sermon to Felix, and what happens is going to determine Felix's eternal destiny. Felix was lost, but he had a chance to be saved on this occasion. Paul preached to him just one sermon. He's only going to have one chance to preach to this heathen man, this Roman judge, and he's going to talk to him about the judgment. Look at verse 25. He says, now as he reasoned about righteousness, self-control, and what? The judgment to come. Paul was a gospel preacher, and the judgment was a prominent part of Paul's preaching. When he had only one chance to talk to somebody about the gospel, he included in his message about the judgment. Now, the apostles all talk about the judgment. It's such a prominent Bible teaching. They all talk about it. Notice what Peter says about it. In 1 Peter, the 4th chapter and the 17th verse, Peter says, for the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? Now notice here, the judgment doesn't happen for everybody at the same time. Did you see that in this verse? It begins with a certain group of people. Who does it begin with? It begins with the house of God. That's where it begins. Now, another fact, we're going through over many facts quickly about the judgment. Another fact about the judgment is that this judgment that begins with the house of God is going to be all over before Jesus comes again. Now, that is very important to understand. Some people are confused about that. Some people think, well, you're going to have a second chance after Jesus comes. Oh, no. The judgment's all over before Jesus comes. Let's read that. Look in your Bible in Revelation 22. It says, he who is unjust, let him be unjust still. He who is filthy, let him be filthy still. He who is righteous, let him be righteous still. He who is holy, let him be holy still. And behold, I am coming quickly. and my reward is with me to give to everyone according to his work. Now, we're going to see in a few minutes that the judgment apportions to everybody according to their work. You're judged according to your works. Now, that's not popular today, but that's what the Bible teaches over and over again. But in this text, just before Jesus comes, he says, my reward is with me to give to everybody according to his work. So the judgment is all over before Jesus comes again. The judgment of the house of God is all over before Jesus comes again, because when he comes, his reward is with him to give to everyone according to his work. It's Revelation 22, 11 and 12. Okay, here's another quick fact about the judgment. The standard of the judgment is the law of God, the Ten Commandments. Let's read that in the Bible. Look in James, the second chapter, verses 8 to 12. It says, if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you do well. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point, he is guilty of all. For he who said, do not commit adultery, what law is he quoting here? The Ten Commandments. Also said, do not murder. What law is that? That's the Ten Commandments. Now, if you do not commit adultery, but you do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so do as those who will be judged by what? By the law. Now, what law is he talking about? We just read it. What law is he talking about? He's talking about the Ten Commandment law. And he says, you're going to be judged by the law. That's a parallel statement. You can't miss it. He quotes the seventh commandment. He quotes the sixth commandment. He says, this is the law. If you break any one of it, you're a lawbreaker, even if you keep the rest. And he says, you live like this because you're going to be judged by the law. You're going to be judged by the law of liberty. So the standard for the judgment is the Ten Commandments. We know that from James 2, verses 8 to 12. Now, we're going to go into some heavy-duty things. We're going to see in a few moments that the judgment is going to begin. We already read that it's going to begin at a specific time. We already read that. Paul said that. And we're going to see in just a few moments that the judgment, according to Bible prophecy, is going to begin a short time after 1798. Is specified in Bible prophecy. We'll see that in just a few moments. Let's look at what is judged. Ecclesiastes 12, 13, and 14. It says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all. For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. That's what made Felix tremble. Paul was telling him about the judgment. And Jesus said in Matthew 10, he said, there is nothing covered that will not be revealed and hid that will not be known. God has records of everything. I had people come to me and say, well, if I confess what I've done wrong, I'll have to go to prison. Or some other awful thing that will happen if they confess what they've done wrong that's hidden, other people don't know. And so I've said to people, well, other people are going to find out. Are they? Jesus said, there's nothing covered up that's not going to be revealed and hid that shall not be known. That's what it says in Matthew 10. So the other people that don't know what you've done, are they going to find out? Well, of course they're going to find out. But you get to choose when they find out. You can confess your sins, the people you've wronged, and ask the Lord to forgive you and make it right. Like Paul says, some men's sins, they go before to judgment, and some men, they follow after. Or you can say, no, I'm going to keep it covered up, and then God will reveal it at the end. Now, the judgment is on the basis of works. We see that here in Ecclesiastes. Let's read some texts in the New Testament that make it very clear that the judgment is on the basis of works. And people don't like to hear this. I've read of Protestant preachers who said, the judgment is on the basis of faith. Show me in your Bible one text where it says the judgment is on the basis of faith. Show me one text. I can show you a whole bunch of texts where it says it's on the basis of works. Here's a few. Matthew 16, verse 27. Jesus himself is speaking. He says, for the Son of Man will come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will reward each according to what? According to his works. Look at what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:10. It says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. So, the judgment is on the basis of character. Your works or your character reveal whether you have received the Holy Spirit. Let's just think that through. As a human being, do I have the power to do anything good? No, I don't. Jesus said, you can't do anything without me. John 15. I do not have the power to do anything good. Read Romans 7. Paul says, there's in my flesh, there's no good thing. I do not have the power. Oh, somebody says, I can do something good. But the question is, it's not just what you did. Was your motive pure and right? Well, you can't do that because you can't generate purity and righteousness and holiness. You can't do that. You can't do what is right and what is good unless the Holy Spirit works a change inside. And that's what Romans 8 is all about. When you walk after the Spirit works a change inside and you have a different spirit. That's what being born again is all about. See, when a baby is born, that's not just a change or modification. That's a completely something new, isn't it? And you know, the Apostle Paul said, if anybody is in Christ, he said, he's a new creation. That's why it's called a new birth. He's a new creation. All things have passed away. Everything has become new. The Holy Spirit gives me new thoughts and new impulses and new desires and creates a new heart in me. And that's a process that goes on. And so, that's why the judgment is according to works. Because my works show whether I have really been born again by the Holy Spirit or not. Because I can't generate any good works. I can't do any good works. But if the Holy Spirit is living in me, the Holy Spirit will produce good works in me. Now, by the way, Jesus taught this over and over again. Let me give you just several texts. So if you want to study this on your own, Jesus taught over and over. It's been an astonishment to me that Protestant preachers are so befuddled on this point when Jesus told so many parables on this very point. Jesus taught that the judgment was on the basis of works. That is, on the basis of character. Your character are your works. The sum total of all your works is your character. Here's several texts you can look up and study where Jesus taught that the judgment is on the basis of character. Matthew 25, 31 to 46. Matthew 25, 14 to 30. Matthew 24, 45 to 51, Matthew 21, 28 to 32, and almost the entire Sermon on the Mount. That's Matthew 5, 6, and 7. Now, Paul said that the judgment begins at a certain time. He says, God has appointed a time. Well, what time did God appoint? Look back to Daniel 7, and here we have the vision of the four beasts, and after the fourth beast, you have a little horn arising, and this little horn is going to persecute the saints for a time, times, and half a time. That's Daniel 7, 25. But then, after the little horn has persecuted the saints for a time and times and half a time, notice what's going to happen. It says in verse 26, but the court, did you get that word? The court shall be seated, and they shall take away his dominion. That's dominion of the little horn, to consume and to destroy it forever. Now, what court is it talking about that is going to take away the dominion of the little horn power? Well, go back to verses 8 to 10. It says, I was considering the horns, and there was another horn, a little one, coming up among them, before whom three of the first horns were plucked out by the roots. And there in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking pompous words. Okay? He says, I watched till thrones were put in place. And the Ancient of Days was seated. His garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head was like pure wool. His throne was a fiery flame, its wheels burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. 1,000 thousands ministered to him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. And it says the court was seated. Now this is a court. That's where you do judgment. That's where you have a court case. The court was seated, and the books were opened. The court was seated, and the books were opened. Now, when is this? If you look down through the context, this is right after the 1260 days. That's the next thing. So we know that the judgment begins a short time after 1798. Now, let's look at a few other facts about the judgment in Daniel 8. In Daniel 8, we have the prophecy of the 2300 days. That's in Daniel 8, verses 13 and 14. This is also in the context of a little horn power. But notice in Daniel 8, it says that the 2300 days extends to the time of the end. It says to the time of the end shall be the vision. That's verse 17. And then in Daniel 8, you also have an interesting description of the little horn power. And I'm bringing this up for a very specific reason. I have found that former Adventists have tremendous trouble in Daniel 8, and they have tried to tell me in their writings and their papers that in Daniel 8 that the little horn power is Antiochus Epiphanes. Now, I want to show you a few things about Daniel 8. You look in your Bible, we're going to go through it quickly. You have a ram. Now, what did the ram represent? The angel tell you what the ram is. That was the kingdom of Medo-Persia, which was a worldwide empire, all right? It says that the ram was great. You got that one? And then you had another power that attacked the ram, and who was that? That was Greece. That was the he-goat with a great horn between its eyes. That was Greece. Now, Greece is described in a different way. The ram was great, but Greece was exceedingly great. And that was the kingdom of Alexander the Great. And then the little horn's broken, and the great horn's broken, and other horns come up, and then a little horn develops. And this little horn is described by the prophet as being great beyond measure. Now remember, you have the ram was great, the he-goat was exceedingly great, but then you have the little horn that was great beyond measure. In other words, the little horn would have to be much greater than Alexander the Great. And these people want to tell me that Antiochus Epiphanes, do you know who Antiochus Epiphanes was? If you're not a theologian, you never heard of him. Antiochus Epiphanes was one of the Seleucid rulers that ruled for a while in the 2nd century BC, one of the divisions of Alexander's empire. He was not greater than Alexander the Great. He wasn't anywhere near as great as Alexander the Great. There is absolutely no way, friend, if you're open to evidence, that you could ever believe that Antiochus Epiphanes could be the little horn because of the language used. The little horn has to be a power that is far greater than Alexander the Great. Now, we saw that the judgment occurs a short time after 1798, according to Daniel 7, 21 to 27. It's a worldwide judgment. You can see that in verse 26 and 27. That determines the destiny of all people. And I want you to see now that the judgment involves an investigation. This has been an astonishment to me, that former Adventists, somehow they seem to hate the word investigation. I don't know why they hate it, but they say, oh, the Bible doesn't teach that. Well, now, wait a minute. Let's just not get hung up because we don't see the word investigation in the Bible. Let's just look at the words and see what they do mean, and you're going to see they're teaching exactly. an investigation. First of all, in Daniel 7:10, it says, I was watching, and the court was seated, and the books were what? The books were opened. Now, if a court is seated and they open books, what are they doing? They're investigating something. But there's many other texts to show that a decision is going to be made in this judgment that is going to determine whether you're going to have eternal life or whether you're not going to have eternal life. Let's read several texts quickly. Look, first of all, in Exodus 32. God's been keeping record in books for a long time, and Moses knew it. And look at what Moses said to the Lord in Exodus 32. It says in verse 32, Exodus 32, if you will forgive their sin, but if not, I pray, blot me out of your book which you have written. That's what Moses said. Just let me be lost. I can't stand it if these people are all going to be lost. Just blot me out of your book too. What did the Lord say? Verse 33. The Lord said to Moses, whoever has sinned against me, I will blot him out of my book. So, in the judgment, if your sins are in the book, you're going to get blotted out. If your sins haven't been taken away, you're going to get blotted out. Now, how can you avoid that happening? Jesus tells you how to avoid it in Revelation 3:5. Look at Revelation 3:5. It says, he who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. All the Bible writers, we just saw about Moses, all the Bible writers knew about these books that God was keeping that would decide people's eternal destiny. All the Bible writers knew about that. Look in the Psalms. Psalm 56, verse 8. David is writing, and he says, you number my wanderings, put my tears into your bottle. Are they not in your book? God has a record. He has a record of every tear that's been shed. It's in his book. In Revelation, over and over it talks about these books. Look at, first of all, at Revelation 13, verse 8. It says, all who dwell on the earth will worship him whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. That's Revelation 13:8. Look at Revelation 17:8. The beast that you saw was and is not and will ascend out of the bottomless pit and go to perdition, and those who dwell on the earth will marvel whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world when they see the beast that was and is not and yet is. Look at Revelation 20. Revelation 20, verse 12. I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. Verse 15. Anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So God has books. And he has records. And what's written in those books determines our destiny. And I want you to see now that God is going to conduct an investigation. Now, I hear Protestant preachers say, oh, God knows everything. He doesn't need to investigate. All I know is what the Bible says. And the Bible says that God's going to have an investigation. That's what the judgment involves, investigation. Let's read it. Look in Romans, the 8th chapter. And verse 27 says, now he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Notice, it talks about the person that searches hearts. Now let me ask you a question. Do you know what it means to search for something? To search means to conduct an investigation. That's what it is. To search for anything means you're investigating. In fact, to search and to investigate mean the same thing. The synonym word. And God conducts a search. Look at Revelation 2. Revelation 2. And it says here in verse 23, I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I, this is Jesus speaking, that I am he who searches the minds and hearts, and I will give to each one of you according to your works. Jesus said, I'm the one that's conducting an investigation. I'm the one. And people somehow can't figure this out. Jesus says, I'm conducting an investigation. I'm searching. What am I searching? What am I conducting an investigation about? Your minds and your hearts. Literal language says your hearts and your kidneys. They thought in ancient times that the kidneys was the emotional center where the feelings were located. Look in Psalm 139. This is a prominent Bible teaching. I want you to see this is not just something I just picked a verse here or there. This is a prominent Bible teaching. Look at Psalm 139 and verse 1. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. And then he goes ahead and asks the Lord, well, search me, Lord. That's verse 23. Know my heart. Try me. Know my anxiety. See if there's any wicked way in me. So, God conducts a search. That's an investigation. Look in Jeremiah 17. Jeremiah 17, verse 10. It says, I, the Lord, search the heart. In other words, that's to conduct an investigation. I search the heart. I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings. And one of my favorite texts on this general subject is in 1 Chronicles 28. 1 Chronicles 28, verse 9. 1 Chronicles 28, 9. It says, as for you, my son Solomon, know the God of your father and serve him with a loyal heart and with a willing mind, for the Lord searches all hearts and understands all the intent of the thoughts. If you seek him, he will be found by you, but if you forsake him, he will cast you off forever. So we see that God conducts an investigation. That's what the Bible says. He searches. He searches all hearts, all minds. He conducts an investigation of people to know what's in their heart and what's in their mind. Now, when does he do this? Well, we've already seen when he conducts the judgment. It's in Daniel 7. It happens a short time after 1798. But let's look at one other text that gives us an idea about when this happens. Look in the book of Zephaniah. Zephaniah, the first chapter. And now, in this chapter, it's talking about the great day of the Lord. Notice it says, the Lord says in verse 2, I will utterly consume everything. Verse 3, I will consume man and beast. I will consume the birds of the heavens, the fish of the sea. I will cut off man from the face of the land. Has that happened yet? No, it hasn't. The beasts of the field, the fish of the sea, and all men, they haven't all been cut off yet, but it's coming. This is the great day of the Lord that he's talking about. And he says in verse 7, what time period is he talking about? He said, be silent in the presence of the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is what? It's at hand. So where are we at now in earth's history in this chapter? We're right at the end of time. The day of the Lord, he says, is at hand. He says in verse 14, too, he says, the great day of the Lord is near. Well, what's going to happen when the great day of the Lord is near and the day of the Lord is at hand and destruction is coming from God and it's right around the corner, it's right about to happen. What's going to happen during this time? Well, notice what he says in verse 12. He says, and it shall come to pass at that time. Now, what time is he talking about? He's talking about just before the Lord comes. The day of the Lord is at hand. It's near. And at that time, just before the Lord comes, what's going to happen? I will search. Uh-oh. What's the Lord going to do? He's going to conduct an investigation. He's going to search. Well, what is he going to search? He's going to search Jerusalem, that's the church, with lamps, and punish the men who are settled in complacency, who say in their heart, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do evil, so forth. You see, friends, God is going to conduct an investigative judgment. He's going to, just before he comes, he's going to conduct an investigative judgment of Jerusalem, of his people. We already read in Peter, he says, 1 Peter, the judgment begins at the house of God. That's where it begins. And this investigation involves a court setting. Now in a court, even in this world, when you go to court, what do you have? Well, you have a prosecutor, and then you have a defender. If you don't have any money, you have to get a public defender. But if you have money, you can hire an attorney to be your advocate, your defender. So you have a prosecutor, and you have a defense attorney, and you have a judge. And that's the exact thing that happens to God's children right at the end of time. Let's read that in the Bible. Turn over a couple books to Zechariah 3. And notice who, there's a court setting here, a court trial setting, and notice what's going on. And notice who the prosecution is. It says in verse 1, then he showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to oppose him. So who is the prosecution in this case? The devil. Well, who is the defense? Notice, verse 2, the Lord said to Satan, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is this not a brand plucked from the fire? But now there's a problem with God's people. And what is the problem? The problem is, in verse 3, it says, Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and was standing before the angel. So God's people are clothed in filthy garments. What does the filthy garments represent? Garments all the way through the Bible, from the beginning to the end, represent your character. In the Battle of Armageddon, Jesus says in Revelation 16, 15, blessed is he that watches and keeps his garments so that he doesn't walk naked and they see his shame. Your garments represent your character. And Joshua's clothed in filthy garments. In other words, he has sinful garments on. Well, what is going to happen? It says in verse 4, then he answered and spoke to those who stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. And to him he said, see, I have removed what? Your iniquity. Taking away the filthy garments means taking away your iniquity, blotting out your sins. I've taken away your iniquity, removed your iniquity from you, and I will clothe you with rich robes. Verse 5, and I said, let them put a clean turban on his head. So they put a clean turban on his head, and they put the clothes on him, and the angel of the Lord stood by. And notice what the angel of the Lord now says to God's people. Verse 7, thus says the Lord of hosts, if you will walk in my ways and if you will keep my command. What's that about? If you'll keep my law, if you'll keep my command, if you walk in my ways, then you're going to get to judge my house. You're going to get to dwell in my courts. Have charge of my courts, and I'll give you a place to walk among those that stand here. That's verse 7. And then notice what it says in verse 8. It says, hear, O Joshua the high priest, you and your companions who sit before you, they are men of a sign or men of wonder. What are these men of a sign or men of wonder? Well, because it says in verse 9, the Lord says, I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day. Do you know, friends, if we studied carefully, we wouldn't need a lot of other information. Just Zechariah 3 would be enough so that you could figure out the doctrine of the investigative judgment. This is enough, just this one chapter. You have a prosecuting attorney, you have a defense, and the Lord is going to make a judgment. The filthy garments are going to be removed, they're going to be given a change of clothes, and their iniquity is going to be taken away, but this is going to be done only for people who who keep God's commandments, who walk in His ways. It's not going to be for the people that say, well, I believe, but then they keep walking in the way of sin. It's going to be only the people that walk in God's ways and keep His commandments. The doctrine of the investigative judgment is taught as clearly in Zechariah 3 as any other chapter in the Bible that I know. It's just that we haven't paid enough attention to it. You see, friends, the doctrine of the investigative judgment, as I've thought this over in my mind, remind me of a story that I heard about a Christian who was talking with a non-Christian. And the Christian said to the person that was a non-believer, he said, well, look, he said, if you're right and there's no God and there's no future life, I'm not hurt. I'm just the same as you. I'm going to be in the same boat as you are. But, he said, the Christian said, if I'm right and you're wrong, and there is a future life, you're lost. And you're going to burn up someday. Now, you know, friends, as I've thought about this, this is an awful way to have to put it. But if the people that are teaching the new theology and that don't believe in the investigative judgment, if they're right and I'm wrong, I don't have anything to worry about. Because I profess faith in Christ, and I've professed faith in Him, and I'm called myself a Christian, and I've given my life to Him. So if they're right and I'm wrong, I don't have anything to worry about. I'll be automatically saved. But let me tell you, if what we read from the Bible tonight is right, and these people are wrong, these people that profess faith in Christ and don't obey the commandments are going to end up where they didn't expect to end up. They're going to end up being lost instead of saved. And that would be a terrible, terrible thing. And friends, we need to appeal, not to try to prove anybody right and wrong. It's not a matter of trying to prove right and wrong. It's just trying to find out, what does the Bible really say? And the Bible really does teach that God is going to search every heart. And the Bible tells us when He's going to do it. He's going to do it just before He comes again. It's going to happen after 1798, just before Jesus comes again. He's going to do it. He's going to search every heart, everybody. And a decision is going to be made so that when Jesus comes back, His reward is going to be with Him, and you're either going to be saved or lost, and that's going to be the end. And at that time, either your sins are going to be blotted out, according to Acts 3, 19 and 20 to 22, or your name will be blotted out. People say, oh, I don't believe that. Well, friend, if you don't believe it, and you're right, the rest of us are not in trouble. But if the Bible does teach investigative judgment and you go along as though it's not going to happen and don't worry about it and not prepared for it, what's going to happen to you when your sins can't be blotted out because you're still living in sin? What's going to happen to you, friend? Well, friend, if the Adventist message is right, and I believe it is because I've spent a lot of time checking it out, if the Adventist message is right, then if you go down that road and just say, well, it doesn't matter, I can live however I want to, and I'll be saved anyway, you will come to the day of God, and it'll be for you a bitter disappointment. The most awful thing that could happen to you. Thinking that you're saved, and you come right up to the end, and the Lord says, well, no. No, you didn't pass the judgment. You weren't living according to my law. Your heart wasn't filled with the Holy Spirit. Your filthy garments were never taken away. You're not saved. You're not a loyal subject of my kingdom. What are you going to do then? See, the time to check it out and to be sure that you're on the right side is now. And even though it may be the most unpopular doctrine in the world, don't ever forget, friend, that Jesus and the apostles and the prophets all said that the judgment is on the basis of works. It's on the basis of character. You're saved by your faith. It's only the merits of Jesus that can give you eternal life. But you're judged on the basis of your works. Your salvation is your title to heaven. But to get to heaven, you have to have a fitness for heaven. And to have a fitness for heaven, you have to pass the judgment, which is on the basis of your character, your works. Don't ever forget that, friend. Jesus taught it over and over again. Read Matthew 21 to 25. Read the Sermon on the Mount. Read 2 Corinthians 5:10. Read Romans 14. Read Ecclesiastes 12, 13 and 14. It's all through the Bible. Don't be deceived by somebody that just talks about half the gospel. We're more than out of time. Let's pray and ask the Lord to help us to be ready to pass the judgment and have our filthy garments taken away. Father in heaven, help us as we study our Bibles to understand clearly what the Bible teaches about the judgment and about the fact that you are going to investigate every single person in this world. You are going to search every heart, every mind, and that every thought of our minds, every desire of our minds, all of our words and our actions are going to come in review before you. And a decision is going to be made whether we have eternal life or eternal death. Help us to understand the seriousness of life. Help us to understand that we can only have assurance if we are walking in the Spirit and if Jesus is living in us through His Holy Spirit. And we pray that You'll help each one of us, that we may be born again and be walking in the Spirit every day. We pray this in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen.
Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things. Who brings out their host by number? He calls them all by name. By the greatness of His might and the strength of His power, not one is missing. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let Your glory be above all the